In order to really understand Agile, it's important to know what Agile isn't. Agile didn't just appear from a vacuum. It was a reaction to the way software was being written in the 80s and 90s. Back then, most of us did something called Waterfall. I mean, Waterfall was really the best case scenario because sometimes there was absolutely no process at all. But when there was a process, it was often Waterfall. And even Waterfall had a lot of different versions, but we're going to look at the most optimistic one that actually, you know, included some design. When you look at a waterfall, it makes some sense. Somebody, probably a product manager, comes up with an idea for what needs to be built and presents some requirements. These could take a lot of different forms, but frequently they were in something called a product requirements document, or a PRD, or sometimes a marketing requirements document, MRD. These were frequently extremely long documents with a lot of detail about what a product should do. In the best case scenario, that detail was drawn from research and an understanding of the needs of both the user and the business, and in reality, maybe not quite so much. Once the product managers were done, then we entered the design phase. Now, design was often its own little sort of mini waterfall, but again, in the best cases, it was good, solid, user-centered design process, one that you're hopefully familiar with. It involved lots of user research to understand users in their context, and lots of ideating and iterating and prototype testing and all of that good stuff. In the worst cases, well, we drew a lot of pictures of things that would never get built, to be honest. The thing is that with these long cycles, the requirements gathering and design process could last a while, almost always months, sometimes a year, it depended on how big the product was, and a lot of times this was all before a single line of code got written. That's because when you look at waterfall, each little drop-off is really what's called a staged gate. What that means is that after the process happened, the requirements document or the design or whatever, there would be a review process of the output before it moved through the gate to the next step. Development couldn't happen before design ended because the design had to be fully vetted before resources were committed to building. After all, you wouldn't want to spend a lot of money writing code if everything was just going to change, right? Again, this all sounds really reasonable. Everybody agrees what we're building before we start building it. Who could be against this? Well, we're not done yet. Since requirements gathering was done before the design process, often things would show up in the design phase that invalidated something from the requirements doc. Maybe something changed in the 6 months that product management took to write up 300 pages. Maybe we learned new information in user research. Who can say? Things change, which meant going back to redo the requirement. And then back again once the requirements were fixed. Also, since design worked independently of engineering most of the time, even after the design phase was, you know, over, it was not unusual for engineers to send the finished designs back with a nasty note saying, "This is a pipe dream and will take us 400 years to build," or something like that. That's always what it sounded like to me anyway. The same thing happened with quality assurance team at the testing step, except they would just file bugs for the engineers to fix. Anyway, what all of this means is that the diagram often looked more like this. And it took a really, really long time. In a lot of cases, there wasn't any way to get around this process, since at the end of the waterfall, we'd be printing a bunch of CD-ROMs or even putting things directly into hardware, so there was really no going back and fixing stuff later like you can with internet-connected software. The real problem, though, lay in the complete separation of the departments. Engineering often didn't get much input into the process until requirements were already set, despite the fact that requirements could be drastically affected by engineering decisions, and requirements sometimes changed even from the time that the 300-page document was written and approved to when the engineers finished working on it. In other words, market forces could change, or we could learn things from the users, or the engineers would find some really hard problem that couldn't be solved, and then everything had to be changed. Because it was incredibly hard to change one thing in that 300-page document without everything cascading. Because of the waterfall, get it? If something on page 28 changed, it meant that everything from page 29 to 300 also needed to change, and that was what we like to call an enormous nightmare. Let's not even talk about feature creep, which happened when people from step one realized that they'd forgotten a whole bunch of stuff and tried to squeeze it in around step three or four, causing the requirements to balloon out of control and all of the deadlines, which were ridiculous in the first place, would just get missed. Anyway. Is there really any wonder why the engineers of the time might be interested in something a little bit more flexible? Something where maybe every single decision didn't get made up front and then changed later? Something where we admit that we don't know everything, so we're not going to bother trying to specify everything out to the last bit and byte, and we're going to build some stuff and get feedback and adjust as we go. Throw in the fact that around this time, websites and web applications were really starting to take off, and it was getting a lot easier to get feedback directly from customers and make continuous changes rather than having to chisel everything into stone before packaging it all up and sending it to the store to sit on shelves, which is how people used to buy software. I mean, not the stone part, but the store part. Obviously, this wasn't everybody's experience of Waterfall. Between you and me, a lot of really good stuff has been built Waterfall fashion. It's not a horrible system. In fact, most physical products and large civic projects like bit bridges and skyscrapers are built in a mostly Waterfall fashion. But it's also not surprising that a lot of high-level engineers were not huge fans of it, and they'd come up with something that was significantly less frustrating for them. And it's really not surprising that it would catch on.